In the beginning, God created heaven and earth. The earth was without form, and darkness was upon the land. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters and said, "Let there be light." And there was light.
Akahuk nunataitlhu. Chahuk tamarmitan yachtkaperlu.
Once there was no earth. Night was everywhere. Raven, alone in an empty world, walked across the heavens. In his tracks, bright stars appeared. At the edge of the ocean, he stopped and called to the seal, "Bring me some earth from the bottom." After 6 days, seal, exhausted and speechless, returned. Mud was on his flippers. Raven took the mud and flew away. As he flew, he scattered it on the water. Wherever it fell, there grew islands and land with streams, forests, and animals.
Like the mists swirling about her shores, Alaska's early beginnings are shrouded in mystery. And yet, from the clues the land provides, a rock, an ancient bone, a strange petrified redwood forest on a treeless island, we have uncovered a fantastic story. The land is old, but Alaska is young. Millions and millions of years ago, great earth-shaping forces caused fragments of land to break off and slowly drift north. They came together like pieces of a gigantic jigsaw puzzle. Some were from the ocean crust, others from the edge of some ancient unknown continent. Most originated far to the south in warmer climates. That's why people were baffled when they found the fossils of a tropical forest in interior Alaska, or the petrified remains of giant redwood trees on the treeless islands of the Aleutians. The forces which shape the land are still at work, the cause of Alaska's tumultuous nature. It is by far the most turbulent region of the continent. The mountains are still rising. The land trembles with earthquakes. The sweeping arc of volcanoes erupt continually along Alaska's coast, spewing forth smoke, fire, and ash. And glaciers, those colossal remnants of the last great ice age, are still carving their signature upon the land. And yet surprisingly, although Alaska is one of the youngest additions to the continent, it is the place of the oldest human habitation. For it was here, thousands and thousands of years ago, that the first humans set foot in America. Alaska and the rest of the world was in the grip of the last great period of the Ice Age. Much of the water of the world was locked up in ice. The level of the seas fell dramatically, exposing a broad rolling plain between Alaska and Siberia. This plain now lies at the bottom of the Bering Sea. But thousands of years ago, when the first waves of people wandered across from Asia into this great empty continent, they became the ancestors for all of America's Aboriginal people. In pursuit of game animals, these Asiatic hunters crossed from one continent to the other, first by land, then by sea. There is no record of earlier human existence in all the Americas. Distant ancestors of the people we call Indians were the first arrivals, perhaps more than 20,000 years ago. In time, these nomadic hunters spread south into the grasslands of North America, through Mexico, and all the way to the tip of South America. Some built golden, legendary civilizations. The ancestors of the people we know as Eskimos and Aleuts were among a later migration of people across the Bering land bridge. By that time, the world had warmed up. Glaciers were melting. The land connection between Alaska and Siberia was fast disappearing. As the first people became separated by hundreds of miles and thousands of years, they developed distinctly different lives and cultures, all profoundly shaped by the land where they settled. And thus, on the eve of European discovery, Alaska was inhabited by three major groups of people. Although they called themselves by different names, the world has come to know them as Indians, Eskimos, and Aleuts.
Where the mountains plunge to the sea, the great ocean spirit, Gonagadet, welcomed Raven to a rich feast. Once finished, the kindly spirit donned his exquisite dancing robe. Drums echoed the pounding waves as Gonagadet swung his body rhythmically to the music. In the ghostly light of the fire, he became a wolf, a bear, an eagle. Raven's heart beat wildly. When the dance was done, the generous spirit offered Raven his beautiful dancing blanket. Raven flew away and in time offered his gift to women so they might unravel the mysteries of the blanket and weave it again. It was in this way that the women brought great glory to the Indian people of the coast, but most of all to the Tlingits of the Chilkat Mountains, for they became the greatest weavers of all.
Along the coast where the mountains meet the sea, there lived the Haida, great carvers, and also the Tsimshian, people of many riches. But it was the Tlingits who dominated this far northern coast, which one day would be called Alaska. They lived much like their neighbors, the Kwakiutls, to the south. Isolated from the interior by dark, forbidding mountains, the Indians of the North Pacific settled this long, narrow strip of coastline, building their villages in sheltered coves or along riverbanks, and forging remarkable civilizations. All were dependent on the sea. The people were rich, and the sea was richer. Every year, Hooligan, the magic oilfish, and Salmon, the great swimmer, returned to the rivers to nourish their people. Whales, seals, porpoise, even the tiny shellfish found along the beaches added richness to the villagers' harvest. The forests were thick. Rows of sculpted poles faced out to sea. Like crests of the medieval knights, the totems reflected the family's glory and the animal spirits which protected it. In the winter, when the days were dark, the people gathered in their great houses of cedar. It was a time for weaving, carving magnificent headdresses, fashioning armor and plotting strategy, or telling stories of greatness. It was also a time for potlatches, elaborate celebrations of feasting, gambling, dancing, in honor of the dead or to glorify the living. To impress the assembled with his wealth, the chief might sacrifice several slaves, or perhaps in an even more extravagant moment, cut his cherished dancing blanket into strips, giving them as gifts to his guests. But woe to those who crossed the Tlingits, for they were fierce warriors. Their armor alone could paralyze the enemy with fright. In war, the slaves they captured were traded to the north or the south for large cedar war canoes, Chilkat blankets, copper, caribou skins, and Hooligan oil. The oil of the Hooligan fish was so valuable that the trade route to the interior from the coast was nicknamed the Grease Trail. The Indians of the interior, the Athabascans, lived differently than their cousins, the Tlingits and Haidas in the south, for the land was not nearly so bountiful. They were always on the move in search of bear, beaver, caribou, muskrat, and birds. In the season when the moose lose their antlers, the people move to fall hunting grounds. Men took their bows and filled their quivers with arrows. Their fire-making bags, sewn with bird claws and porcupine quills, softly rattled as they disappeared over the tundra into the forests. The caribou and moose killed in the hunt were eaten from the flesh down to the very marrow of the bones. Antlers were carved into tools, bones fashioned into knives, Hides slung over poles became their homes, and the skins, chewed to perfect softness by the women and elaborately decorated with beads of porcupine quills, were the envy of all who saw them. The Tlinkits, who had no tailored clothing, traveled many miles and exchanged much wealth for full Athabascan dress. From the season of the first salmon to the time the ducks returned again, wherever hunting was best, the people traveled, from camp to camp. In spring, they stripped the bark from the white birch tree and fashioned it into lightweight canoes. For winter, they invented snowshoes. But there were many lean years when food was scarce and hunger a constant companion. The world they lived in was filled with animal spirits. In times of severe hunger, the people might eat mink or otter, but they almost never ate the meat of the wolf, for the wolf was brother to man, and it was wise to be respectful.
Once, long ago in the land of the Eskimo, there lived a powerful shaman. His leg was twisted, his hair matted, his eyes wild. At times he was feared, but always respected. For he spoke to the spirits of the invisible world, a world the people could not explain. One year, the whales did not return to the coast. In desperation, the people went to the shaman. He fell to his knees, writhing and chanting. As he flapped his arms, they turned into the wings of a bird, and he flew into the sky on a journey to the moon. It was a dangerous trip, but the great spirit of the Arctic moon was pleased with his gifts. A beautiful bird feather parka and sealskin mukluks. So he gave the shaman one whale. Once back on Earth, the shaman turned it loose, and the whale multiplied and came again to these shores.
The life of the Eskimo in this far northern land was unpredictable, when man could turn to animal and animal to man. The Eskimo lived mainly on the coast. The Yupik near the Bering Sea. The Inupiat at the edge of the Arctic Ocean. It was a world of extremes. Summer's midnight sun and winter darkness. Flat, treeless land and frozen seas. Temperatures that plummeted well below zero for much of the year. For the Eskimo, the ocean was the bread of life. There swam the seal, walrus, and the great whale, the bowhead. In their umiaks, the Inupiat pushed through the ice into the open leads. As the great creatures rolled to the surface, the harpooner let his weapon fly. Success in the hunt brought great glory. One kill meant food for many, many days. Everyone shared and rejoiced. But for the Yupiks farther south, the seal was the center of life. Not only was it food, but the oil from its blubber gave heat and light. Seal skin became boots or pants, and its guts were turned into floats or waterproof parkas. Far to the south, millions of years ago, liquid fire bubbled to the surface of the ocean, creating these volcanic islands that stretch like a curved saber toward the heart of Siberia. It is here the cold Bering Sea meets the warm waters of the Pacific Ocean. Storms are violent, the islands are rocky and bare, but the waters teem with life. It was here the Aleuts, distant cousins of the Eskimos, eventually settled. In their skin boats, the Bidarka and the Umiak, they were masters of the sea. They hunted everything from salmon to sea lion to whale. For the hunt, they donned their best clothes in honor of the guest who came to be killed. Before whaling, the harpooner dipped his lance in poison, its origin a mystery. Some said it was made on a new moon, deep in a sea cave, from the juices of a human corpse. Others said it was mixed from the poisonous root of the monkshood flower, which grows in abundance along the Aleutian chain. Only the harpooner knew its secret. We live like our brother the sea otter, the Aleut said. Indeed, with his seal-gut parka fastened to the rim of his bidarka, the Aleut hunter was completely waterproof. It was said that a man was the hunter his wife made him. For if his parka did not keep out wind and water, he would die. Once afloat, he could roll in the waves like the playful sea otter, fearing nothing. The Aleuts hunted many sea otter, but never too many. All thrived on this stormy arc of islands, until one day strange wood drifted in on the sea.
The shaman was troubled. In his dreams, he had seen a floating village of men dashed upon the rocks. It was a day of burial. The omen was not good. A brave leader had died. The people had lain him in an icy cold stream for 3 days, then gutted him and filled his body with moss and herbs. Today they would take him to the sea cave where he would sit and be preserved there for all eternity.
Life would go on, but never as it had once been. For thousands of years, the people of Alaska had adapted well to their world. They flourished in harmony with land and sea, although not always harmoniously with their neighbors. It was a world they understood. But looming beyond the mists was a world unknown, a world that was about to discover their existence and change their way of life forever.